evening. Today, on this Saturday evening, we are going to discuss perioperative pulmonary and renal complications. Both these complications are important from exam viewpoint. More important for our day-to-day practice, because what our mind doesn't know, what we are not carrying with us every morning on rounds, we will never pick it up early in our life. So friends, I will request the younger friends to write down some of the important aspects. Whatever are your queries, you can post it, and at the end of the lecture, I will answer one and all. Now, few facts. We are going to discuss the pulmonary complications first. There are few facts regarding pulmonary complications. Number one, they are more common than cardiac complications. Number two, lot of them can be prevented to a larger extent. Number three, after the most delicately executed major surgery, if the lungs are not taken care of and the patient develops post-operative respiratory failure, the 30-day mortality is 26%, which is much more than a perioperative MI, where the mortality is not more than 15%. Now, there are various definitions on this issue, but there are a few common facts which are welcome, Dr. Surendra Sharma. Some of the common facts, like pneumonia, respiratory failure, bronchospasm, atelectasis, and worsening of COPD. Now, the risk factors are divided into surgery related risk factor and patient related risk factor. Now, surgery related risk factors we'll discuss first. The first most important thing is surgical site related risk. Remember, the thoracic and upper abdominal surgeries have much higher risk than a lower limb surgery. But there are few exceptions. Non-torso surgeries, when we say have abdominal thoracic surgeries, have higher risk than non-torso. But neurosurgery, surgery on palate and oral cavity carries, welcome Professor Bilal. Thank you for encouraging. And palate and mouth carry a higher risk for such complications. Duration of surgery, whenever a surgical procedure lasts more than 2 hours, the lung complications increase. Type of anesthesia, neuroaxial. When I say neuroaxial, that means the examples are spinal, epidural, axillary block. Surgery done in that particular blocks have much lesser lung complications. We will discuss it later. So, good evening, Dr. Raj. So then there are patient-dependent factors. Patient-dependent factors are, number one, COPD. Remember, the worse is COPD, higher the complications. There's a large spectrum of COPD. The worse COPD, more chances of lung complications. But a stabilized COPD of minor degree does not add to the risk. Asthma is the second issue. Well-controlled asthma does not increase the risk factors. There is controversial data on interstitial lung disease and obesity. Pulmonary hypertension carries a higher risk of lung complications, morbidity and mortality. Poor health means poor nutrition and poor performance status adds to the risk factor. Age more than 60. The first lot is age more than 60. Then the second level comes age more than 75. 75 is the worst off, but at 60 is a cutoff when the complication increases. Smoking, an important issue. More is the volume of smoke inhaled or the cigarettes per year or packs per year, what we call, higher the chances of complications. Then history of obstructive sleep apnea poses a higher risk of lung complications. So if I have to say the patient factors, I repeat, COPD, asthma, interstitial lung disease, obesity, pulmonary hypertension, age more than 60, smoking and sleep apnea increase the risk of lung complications. Diagnosis. Now here I want to raise a point which is my primary concern, and I appeal through all the senior faculty on LGS. Lessons, it is our duty to imbibe a culture of using this machine, which I want to show you. The best machine on surgical rounds is a stethoscope. Unfortunately, it has vanished from our practice. It is considered a taboo for a surgeon to carry a stethoscope, as if surgical patients do not have a pair of lungs and heart in the chest. Anyway, there should be on history taking, there should be history of lung disease. We need to know if the patient has current upper respiratory tract infection. We need to know all the details of smoking. On examination, number one, the AP diameter of the chest increases. Number two, there are added sounds. Number three, the laryngeal height, if more than 4 centimeters, indicates higher risk factor for lung complications. The last and the most important bedside test, which is done in our unit on every single patient, is called cuff test. You ask the patient, I will demonstrate, you ask the patient to cough and to impress upon the patient, you said, when he coughs once, if his lungs, trachea and larynx are non-infective, non-diseased, he will follow you only with one cough. But when the patient who has pulmonary disease or laryngitis, tracheitis, you ask him to cough once, after one cough, he gets a persistent cough, which indicates you to investigate him further. On investigative part, lung function test is controversial. It is only indicated if there is unexplained pulmonary symptoms and in an unclear lung disease to have a baseline of pulmonary function. ABG is important only if you want to document that the lung disease is being compensated. Chest X-ray, if your auscultation is clear, if patient has no symptoms, if there are no added sounds, chest X-ray does not add anything. It might show some old healed tuberculosis in one of the apices, which will not change your line of management. The single important test, which is a predictor of pulmonary complications, is serum albumin less than 3.5. So, but at the same time, low albumin signifies higher percentile of lung complications. But correction of albumin by IV albumin or TPN in a perioperative period does not decrease the chances of lung complications. So this is important. Now, next point is, what are the factors which are modifiable? Whenever we approach a patient, number one, we need to know what are the risk factors of surgery. Number two, what are the risk factors of the patient? Number three, we should think, can we modify these factors? If we can and the surgery is elective, we must. And if we cannot, then we should be more vigilant. So, first important thing is smoking. And it has been demonstrated by Mayo Clinic that stopping smoking for more than 2 months is a single important factor to lower the pulmonary complications. 10 years ago, we also used to say sudden stopping of cigarette can worsen the lung complications. That myth of rebound phenomena is no more scientifically justifiable. In COPD patients, preoperative steroids in a group of patients who have received the maximum dose of bronchodilators help if the target is not achieved with bronchodilator alone, and if there is a change in color of sputum, culture. Good evening, Dr. Vipul. If the change in color of sputum, culture and antibiotics can decrease the pulmonary complications. Then there are procedure related situations. Even a patient who has minimal pulmonary risk factors, you must try to modify, to optimize the patient as far as possible. The two surgical modifications are, number one, laparoscopic surgery for the same procedure, if can be safely done, this decreases the pulmonary complications. Number two, instead of GA, if you give neuroaxial anesthesia, the complication rate is lesser. In post-operative interventions, single important thing is lung expansion exercises. In other words, pre-operative incentive spirometry. On our service, no patient is given date. I'm such a hardliner on this, that no patient is given date for elective surgery till he or she can lift two balls of incentive spirometry on either sides. And that makes a difference. A pre-operative training of the patient, which is carried out through the perioperative period, it decreases the chances of pulmonary complications. Then, non-invasive ventilation in perioperative period, it improves the pulmonary outcome. And CPAP is best evaluated in perioperative period. It decreases the lung complications. Appropriate analgesia. What is appropriate analgesia? A technique with which patient's pain is relieved and patient is still alert. Analgesia by giving tramadol or Butrum and putting the patient to sleep increases the chances of lung complications. I'm talking of an alert patient. How can you achieve that? Number one, by giving blocks. Number two, patient controlled analgesia or intermittent small dose of IV analgesia, which relieves. Let me share with you, long ago, when I was a resident, this is Dr. Eggleston's thought, we were supposed to titrate much before the patient controlled analgesia appeared in literature. His thought was, and which was practiced on every patient, good evening Dr. Shah, 10 cc saline dilution was done for 100 milligrams of pethidine, and we would sit next to the patient and give 10 milligrams of pethidine every hour, 3 minutes. So you give 10 milligrams, talk to the patient, give another 10 milligrams, sit there. Most of the strong muscular guys of Punjab would say at 25 to 30 milligrams of pethidine that I'm okay, I don't have pain. But here is a patient who is alert, upright, and then I will ask him to cough. Incentive parameters were not there. So we used to give them balloons to blow. And that helped. So what I'm trying to say, analgesia, so that the lung secretions don't collect in, patient can cough, clear his throat, the chances of atelectasis are less and infective complications less. Then only selective use of nasogastric tube. As per ERAS protocol, the lung complications are less when NG tube is not used as a blanket rule. And serious use of DVT prophylaxis. We will discuss it on another day, DVT and surgeon. Similarly, I want some of the young resident to attempt and write some 10 lines, smoking and surgeon. Diseases caused by smoking, the diseases which are caused by smoking, diseases which are aggravated with smoking, and how to motivate a patient to quit smoking. This is our everyday challenge. I want all of the youngsters to be good at it. Now, in post-operative period, if the patient needs reintubation for some reason, do not delay it, because delaying can harm the patient. And if a patient develops perioperative atelectasis, how will we detect it? It is only when the patient is febrile, his respiratory rate goes up, and you carry a stethoscope to auscultate the patient and find the breath sounds are diminished. Chest X-ray might show a bit later, more so if there is a segmental collapse. It is your awareness that, am I trying to prevent atelectasis in my every patient? Am I willing to pick it up very early? That is how you will have less number of lung complications. Now, thoracic incisions carry higher risk of an upper abdominal, higher risk of lung complications. Why? Because the muscles are cut. So there is a discontinuity anatomical for a patient to cough. Number two, there is a lot of pain. Number three, by reflex inhibition, the phrenic nerve, because of the pain, the diaphragmatic movements are also splinted. So these are the causes of atelectasis, more in upper abdominal and thoracic incisions. Now, intraoperatively, to prevent such complications, we need to do lung protective ventilation, which means 6 to 8 mL per kg body weight. When it was compared with a conventional 10-12 mL of the gas per kg, the lung complications were lesser, to the tune of 10% compared to 27%. Intraoperatively, the incision, the time less than 2 hours, and emergency surgery have higher chances of lung complications. And friends, it is your thought process. When you think of lung complications on your every patient, then only you will not see lung complications. Until it is in your thought, it is practiced every day, and you use stethoscope, don't think it below your dignity, the things will be better. So we have discussed lung complications, its importance, high mortality in perioperative if there is respiratory failure, and so many conditions which can be modified in all elective cases, provided we take interest in them. In our patients, only surgeon has to be perioperative physician. I have worked in bigger hospitals. We have so many pulmonologists, so many internists, but let me tell you, very few people take interest in a surgical patient. Just come, add one dose of more bronchodilator, one more nebulizer, and that's all. You cannot ask them to see your patient 3 times a day. So some basic things you need to learn yourself. Now, the next important topic we are shifting to, part B, is renal complications. Now, we have two types of renal issues in surgical patients. first few lines regarding a surgical patient who has pre-existing renal failure. That means a chronic renal failure patient coming for elective or emergency surgery. Now, let's remember through this lecture, every patient of CKD has very high chance of already having a documented coronary artery disease. So we look for it, optimize it. Otherwise, we are going to have perioperative MACE. MACE, if you remember in my last lecture, MACE, M-A-C-E, stands for Major Adverse Cardiac Events. Now, end-stage renal disease has much higher mortality, we should know. And third point is, general anesthesia, most of the gases are not nephrotoxic. But hemodynamic disturbances during surgery can precipitate acute renal injury in a chronic renal failure. Now, we need to maintain euvolemia. Neither the hypovolemia nor hypervolemia is good for such a patient in perioperative period. If there is, there are two main issues in renal failure. Number one, hyperkalemia. If ordinary medical measures don't work, such patients should be dialyzed. Or if the dialysis has to be done, it should be done a day earlier only. And all the electrolytes should be evaluated and corrected before surgery. Second point is bleeding. Because in CKD, the platelet function is low. Remember, dialysis improves platelet function. And if there is still bleeding, then desmopressin or cryoprecipitate helps. Such details you don't need to know. Now, more important is ARI, acute renal injury in a perioperative patient. First, remember, acute renal injury or acute kidney injury is an independent risk factor for all surgical patients. It increases morbidity and mortality, whereas the regular mortality of all major non-cardiac patients, non-cardiac surgery, all-cause mortality is 4%. Once this patient develops renal failure, the mortality becomes 12%, three times. That is the significant. And the morbidity may not be only short term. Remember, morbidity may not be only short term. The morbidity may become chronic because the renal insult may convert it into a chronic renal failure. Now, to summarize, kidney has several roles in our body: hemostasis, sodium balance, acid-base balance, electrolyte balance, and excretion of metabolites. Now, AKI, acute kidney injury, is defined as sudden significant decrease in renal function leading to rapid fall in GFR and renal function. In surgical patients, there are cytokinines which damage the cells, and the same effect in AKI also can act on the brain, lungs, and heart. By definition, the acute kidney injury is now very minutely studied and is classified into the severity of AKI by three groups. One common word which the resident should remember is RIFL criteria, where R stands for risk, I for injury, F for failure, L for loss of function, and E for end stage renal function. To classify, there is an Akin classification. We are not going to be nephrologists. But one basic thing you should need to know, that the final classification is stage 1. This is a KidGO classification, which we should remember, because it covers everything. Stage 1 means where the creatinine is between 1.5 to 1.9, or there is 0.3 milligram rise in creatinine beyond the baseline, and urine output is less than 0.5 ml per kg per hour in first 6 to 12 hours. Stage 2 is, 1 was 1.5 to 1.9, easy remember. Stage 2 is 2 to 2.9, and stage 3 is 3 or more, or a patient who requires renal replacement therapy. Similarly, the urine output in stage 2 is less than 0.5 ml per kg per hour for more than 12 hours. And in stage is less than 0.3 in more than 24 hours. So, the current status of renal injury involves, number 1, serum creatinine, number 2, urine output, number 3, the duration of oliguria. So all the components are taken care. So what is the highlight point? Most of the surgeons on a perioperative period do not consider 0.3 increase in creatinine as a significant issue. This is my aim of presenting renal failure today, that if the preoperative creatinine was 0.9 and on day 1 creatinine is 1.4, so it has gone up by 5.5. It is usually not taken significant. Whereas from a nephrologist viewpoint, since I am seeing my surgical patient, if nephrologist is not my resident or fellow, so until I call him, he will not come. My primary issue of presenting acute kidney injury is that we should be aware that even 0.3 rise in creatinine is a significant rise. Now, two more important issues which I did. Since creatinine is estimated by a method called Jaffe-Pickering acid method, So this method is color based reading, and patients who have jaundice or uncontrolled diabetes, I'm repeating, patients who have jaundice or hyperglycemia, their serum creatinine estimation would be lower than actual. Now, second point, some healthy people have got a renal reserve, a muscular tall chap, he has a renal reserve. And with the same insult, their rise in creatinine would be lesser than a weak patient with already diseased kidneys. Now, there are some questions related to recent advances, and the young surgeons must know something about biomarkers in AKI. These are a couple of names which you need to remember. I will put it up. I think biomarkers at the end, I will write it in my comments so that you can note down and read a shit more about it. One important thing is that along with creatinine, because creatinine is a poor index of renal function, so current labs have started putting estimated GFR yes, Dr. George, I put a cap because I have very few hairs, and Delhi is very cold these days, so it's a protective for an old man. I want to serve for more number of years and remain fit. So you will see this cap sometime till the end of January or February. So taken the incidence, AKI in all stages perioperative is 13.4%. Majority of them are stage 1, that 70 plus percentile people have stage 1. But in a perioperative period, only 3% require renal replacement therapy. There are some factors which the young surgeons need to remember. There is number one, what are the susceptible patient population? Susceptible patient population prone to AKI. Number one, age more than 65. Number two, patients with diabetes, pre-existing CKD, hypertension, congestive failure. So if you have to remember, an old man, diabetic, CKD, hypertensive, congestive failure, these are the people who are more likely to develop AKI. Now, what are the exposures? Volume depletion, cardiopulmonary bypass, patients on ventilation, vasopressors, and sepsis. These are the exposures. Now, if we have a permutation and combination, we have an old man who is diabetic hypertensive and has CKD. Okay, we forget about CHF. Old man, diabetic hypertensive, CKD, quite regular combination. Now, he has undergone a CABG. Post-op developed pneumonia and is on ventilator and has sepsis. So this is a perfect recipe how the combination on both sides of factor can give rise to renal failure. Now there are some special conditions which we would like to discuss. Number one, laparoscopic surgery. Intra-abdominal pressure which is increased can have transient, you know, oliguria in perioperative period, but the risk of AKI is not increased in laparoscopic surgery. Second, hepatobiliary surgery, the risk of AKI is more than general population because of jaundice, and we know about hepatorenal syndrome. Then the anesthetic management. But some of the inhalational agents decrease renal flow and GFR, whereas isoflurane decreases the risk of AKI. Epidural analgesia may be an independent risk factor for AKI. Propofol and Dexmed are protective agents. Ventilatory inflammatory causes. If the lung is not ventilated with lung protective mechanism, that means if the volume and pressures are not low, the barotrauma produces inflammatory changes, and not only lung, the cytokines released in the lung can also produce AKI. Intra-abdominal pressure or compartment syndrome has been always thought and considered AKI may be the first indicator in form of oliguria. Oliguria may be the first presentation of compartment syndrome. Now what happens? When there is increased pressure, the vena cava is compressed, there is lesser return of blood to the right heart, lesser pumped, lesser cardiac output, and that leads to vasoconstriction. Increased sympathetic tone leads to catecholamines, renin-angiotensin activation, and a vasopressin increased, all lead to AKI. Now, the management is of whatever is compartment syndrome, a separate topic to be discussed sometime. Now, the last issue in perioperative patients is a topic very close to my heart, very sensitive. I have been Good evening, friends. This evening, we are going to discuss carcinoma esophagus. This is a very long, complex topic to discuss in totality. But I am here to discuss today carcinoma esophagus as required to be known by a young surgeon by somebody who is appearing in his exam and preparing for his knowledge to pass his master's exam. Or as much as a general surgeon should know, there is no limit to the knowledge, but since on the day of final exam, you are supposed to know so much of the material, I am here to tell you what you need to remember, which will help you to walk through the examination. So friends, this is a tailored lecture for CA esophagus. So one important thing in epidemiology, you must know that it is 8th common cancer in the world and 6th common cancer in India. Number two, we have an Asian esophageal cancer belt which extends from Turkey to China, and in India the maximum cases are found in Kashmir and Northeast belt. World over, the incidence of squamous cell carcinoma is decreasing and adenocarcinoma is increasing. I repeat, squamous cell is decreasing and the adeno is increasing. As it comes to some of the etiological factors which you should remember. If you remember, a lot of it is diet, namely alcohol, tobacco, smoked fish and pickles, nutritional deficiencies of vitamin A, C, niacin and magnesium, selenium, pollutants in environment, HPV 16 and 18, all causes of chronic esophageal irritation. Now, this all becomes in the dietary factors. Now, then there is a set of esophageal factors. The esophageal factors are three: Barrett, Aclasia, corrosive strictures. So, friends, five causes of diet, three causes of lower esophagus. Repeat: Barrett, Aclasia, corrosive strictures. Then fourth, esophageal diverticulitis, Plummer-Wurstin syndrome and obesity. So that is in nutshell the etiology, easy to remember: nutritional, lower esophagus and obesity. Then a word about Barrett's metaplasia. You can get a short note on Barrett's esophagus, and which will never be complete without knowing about the metaplasia. Now, there are three types of Barrett's metaplasia. Number one, long segment. Long means more than 3 centimeters. Three types of metaplasia. Three is the dominant figure. Three types of metaplasia: long segment, more than 3 centimeter, short segment, less than 3 centimeter. Third, gastric, limited only to the gastric cardia. Now, as long as the importance of Barrett's is, it is found in 5 to 15% of endoscopies for reflux. Now, it is the dysplasia which has increased chances of malignancy. A long segment Barrett's metaplasia should be scoped every year. Remember, routine endoscopy only for dysplasia. Other indications would be intestinal metaplasia, low-grade dysplasia, high-grade dysplasia, invasive carcinoma. Now, interesting, aspirin and NSAIDs, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, are considered to be chemoprotective for this disease. Now, a word about pathology, which you must know. Now, pathology has to be discussed separately as squamous cell carcinoma as adenocarcinoma. Now, squamous cell, majority of them, 55% in the mid esophagus, 30% in the lower esophagus, and 15% in cervical esophagus. The spread is transmural and it is translymphatic, and there are a lot of lymphatics in the submucous area, which leads to longitudinal spread of the disease. Now, the lymphatics are involved erratically. When I say that, means when the disease is in lower third of esophagus, 20 to 30% people will have cervical nodes involved. And when the disease is in upper esophagus, the abdominal nodes may be involved again in 20 to 30%. Now, the nodal relation to the site of disease on T pattern means when mucosal disease, the nodes are 3%. As long as the submucosa is involved, the 3 becomes 30%. And then it multiplies. If it is muscularis involved, it is 60%. If it is transmural, it is 100%. And the blood supply is another route of metastasis, through which the mets occur in liver, kidney, and lungs. Adenocarcinoma of gastroesophageal junction is defined as whose center lies 5 centimeters of anatomic cardia. Now, again, there are 3 types of adenocarcinoma located. Situated in 1 centimeter above the cardia, like Barrett's metaplasia. Number 2, cardia or intestinal metaplasia. And 3, subcardinal gastric carcinoma. Now, there are 2-3 more points you need to remember regarding pathology. The verrucous and spindle cells don't penetrate deep, so they are better cancers in esophagus. Mucoepidermoid and adenocystic carcinomas are aggressive esophageal malignancies. Prognostic factors. The TNM classification means the depth and nodes matter. More than 4 nodes have worse prognosis. Perioperative blood transfusions also worsens the prognosis. Now, the clinical presentation. Usually, it is a male dominant disease, and 6 to 7 decades is the commonest presentation. Early disease can only be picked up by surveillance. So far, China and Japan are only 2 countries which are doing aggressive surveillance. Dysphagia, weight loss are common symptoms. Remember, when there is dysphagia to solids, that means the lumen is less than 13 millimeter. The tumor as it involves the surrounding tissue, other than involving the lumen, it may involve the surrounding tissues to narrow it down. Anemia is usually due to poor intake and low-grade continuous blood loss. Presentation as tracheoesophageal fistula is in approximate 5% of the cases. Hematemesis may be the presentation, very minor hematemesis by tumor erosion or ulceration, and the major hematemesis can occur because of esophageal malignancy eroding into the aorta. Clinical examination of upper airway, head and neck, oral and pharyngeal is mandatory because one can have a synchronous malignancy. The clinical features may be of lymph node masses like in the neck or the celiac axis in the upper abdomen, or the bone pains. The relevant lab is only anemia and hypoalbuminemia. Serum calcium may be high as a paraneoplastic syndrome because squamous cell carcinoma secretes parathormone type of peptide. Now, investigations. The first investigation is chest X-ray. Now, this you can note down. Few things I have condensed down which will help you to make your note for appearing in Viva Visa. When you face a dysphagia, you know the usual story. On the exam day, when the first candidate goes in, he comes out and says, oh, there is a barium swallow with CA esophagus. Now the examiner is also smart. Remember, he also has been a resident some 30, 40 years ago. So when the next candidate comes, he puts on the same barium and now he says, Sunny, what would you expect to see in a chest X-ray of this patient? So I'm giving you a Dalda answer to remember. Note down, chest X-ray in carcinoma esophagus. You are looking at three things. Number one, most of them are smokers. So you can have all the features of a smoker's chest X-ray, like COPD, healed pulmonary tuberculosis, bronchiectasis, all the smoker's picture. Number two, these are the patients when they have obstructive lesions, they can have all the features of aspiration. Number three, he can have metastatic disease. So you can have nodules, you can have effusion on the right, effusion on the left. A common question the examiner wants to know, which is the dominant? How do you know from the side of effusion where is the lesion? This may not be exactly relevant to carcinoma esophagus, but this what I taught day before in my class in relation to perforation. When the perforation is in lower esophagus, the effusion occurs on the left side. And when the perforation is on the mid esophagus, the effusion is most likely on the right side. So that's about the chest X-ray. Then when it comes to barium swallow, now what is the value of barium swallow today? Number one, it acts as a roadmap. Number two, you can see even the distal esophagus till which your scope may not be able to reach. Number three, tracheoesophageal fistula can be picked up. Number last, the axis deviation. I wish I could draw it. If you draw the esophagus, draw a long axis above the tumor, below the tumor, and if there is angulation, that reflects inoperability. Also, we were taught like this, but maybe I didn't find in the current books. If a tumor is, because you can precisely measure on CT today how many centimeters, but in older era, if a tumor is more than size of the two vertebra, it is also called inoperable, right? So that is about barium swallow. If I have to quickly repeat, barium swallow, roadmap, distal configuration, length of the disease, and tracheoesophageal fistula, axis to indicate the operability. Endoscopy. Endoscopy is the most important investigation. So please, the young surgeons can write down the points on endoscopy. Now, first point is, you need to be mentally clear, you are going to take minimum 7 biopsies. Use the word minimum 7 from non-necrotic tumor. There is no point of taking biopsy from the necrosis. You will know the proximal limit, and if you can cross the tumor, you should know the distal limit. All the details would be mentioned as per distance from incisor tooth. Another beauty of endoscopy is you may be able to find a synchronous tumor. You can place then 3 therapeutic points during endoscopy. Number 1, you can place a nasogastric tube across for feeding purposes. Number 2, you can do laser ablation during endoscopy to give passage and to treat dysphagia. You can also insert an endoluminal stent during endoscopy. So friends, these are 6 points which I have told you. And you will be asked the role of endoscopy. See, I want to repeat, the examiner does not expect you to do a esophagectomy or a 3-field lymphadenectomy. He wants to know, as a young surgeon, can you think on the diagnostic area? Can you know the preoperative preparation? Can you manage the patient in perioperative period? All my students are asked only these questions. They are never asked the steps of a 3-field lymphadenectomy or a transhiatal esophagectomy. Yes, they will ask you the principles. Because we have to leave something for your MCH GI. If you will know everything in your DNB, what will you learn in your MCH? So some syllabus has to be left. We have in other spheres of life also, something for the district court, something for the high court, something for the Supreme Court. So the Supreme Court in this area is, when after your GI surgery, you are doing a 4-gut fellowship, that is the Supreme Court of esophagus. So then who needs screening by endoscopy? The answer is those patients, note down, who needs screening? Number 1, Barrett's with dysplastic changes. Number two, upper aerodigestive malignancy, gluteal enteropathy, Plummer-Wilson syndrome, achalasia, males beyond 50 years of age who are smokers and alcoholics. Now, screening biopsies should be done every 2 centimeters in the lower end or suspicious area in all 4 quadrants. The recent advances in endoscopy is chromoendoscopy and magnification endoscopy. If you remember this much, it is good. The brilliant students can read it up. What are the non-endoscopic methods? If you remember 2, it will be good. Abrasive cytology and standard brush cytology. Now, location wise, surgically, how do we distinguish the lower third, middle third? The upper esophagus is from cricopharyngeus to the lower border of azygous vein. The middle is from azygous to inferior pulmonary vein. And the lower segment is from inferior pulmonary vein till gastroesophageal junction. I am skipping the repetitive narration of classification of carcinoma esophagus because all of you need to read it. And what I will suggest, there is a small book which I have reviewed on called Concise Cancer Manual, which gives reasonable data information. I will put the picture in my comments. It is a ready-made notes made by a brilliant young gastroenterologist surgeon, and it's just ready-made stuff. It is available on Amazon and you can get it and read it. It's easier to cram up the data on classification from Concise Cancer Manual. And now, what are the investigations for staging of the disease? EUS tells us the T sensitivity and specificity. It can look into every layer of esophagus to delineate the layer involved. The higher frequency probes of 20 megahertz can identify the difference between T1A and T1B. But what are the limitations? There may be obstructing tumor through which the scope cannot pass. There may be a micro invasion of the tumor cells into the deeper layers, which EUS cannot pick up. There may be peritumoral inflammatory disease which may give a false reading. Lastly, fibrosis around the tumor because of neoadjuvant therapy may also mislead. Remember, EUS is less sensitive for nodal status. Note down the 4 features on EUS for a node to be positive. Number 1, more than 1 centimeter node, which is hypoechogenic, discrete margins and round shape. So these are four features. If all four are present, 80% will be positive on aspiration cytology. Bronchoscopy is important in upper and middle third lesions. The direct infiltration contraindicates operation, and the changes in biopsy during bronchoscopy can change the plan in 10 to 15% patients. So hence, in middle third and upper third, scopy is part of workup. CT, neck, chest and abdomen. CT is highly accurate for M status, means lungs, liver, bone, adrenal. CT is limited for T and N stage. The length of tumor is usually underestimated by 2 to 3 centimeters on CT. In T4 lesions, the mediastinal involvement decides resectability. Normally it is said, if on fat planes are well preserved, the disease has not involved across. But paradoxical to that, this you should write down. Fat planes well preserved, disease not gone across. Fat planes not well preserved. Okay? But still there is no disease. It can happen in cachexia, following radiation and following surgery. So friends, three conditions where, welcome Sudhanshu, three conditions where fat planes are not preserved and still the malignancy has not crossed to the surrounding structure. Cachexia, when the fat is lost anyway, radiotherapy and post-surgery. G-junction tumors also spread transcelomic and drop metastasis into the pelvis and adnexa. Now a word about PET scan. PET scan is best for distant mets. Changes management in 10 to 20% by picking up small metastasis. PET scan has this positivity of picking up smaller mets, but PET is poor for T as, good evening Sudhanshu, as the PET cannot distinguish between T and N lesion. So PET is important for staging after neoadjuvant therapy. It also evaluates the response of chemotherapy or upgrades the tumor. Integrated CT scan into the PET, called PET CT with IV contrast, is more useful. So to conclude, the regional METs more sensitive by EOS, distance METs by PET CT, better than CT scan. PET is the best investigation for evaluation of response of neoadjuvant chemotherapy. If the tumor metabolic activity is decreased by 35% following neoadjuvant, in 2 weeks there will be better survival. Bone scans are sensitive to pick up mets, but there are two conditions: inflammatory bony lesions and fractures, which can be false positive on bone scan. Lab staging: the celiac sampling and liver ultrasound, laparoscopic liver ultrasound, are better than EUS. Now, what can we do in preoperative management of such patients? In the regular classroom sessions, we have discussed this, because this whole week was esophagus, achalasia, stricture, perforation, and eventually the preparation of all of these are the same. Now, what are the issues in esophageal obstructing lesions? So, though we are talking esophagus carcinoma today, but remember this as a bundle for all obstructive benign or malignant. Means somebody asks you achalasia, somebody asks you stricture esophagus, somebody asks you malignancy. The preoperative preparation by far will remain the same. What is the first issue? Nutrition. They are all nutritionally poor, and you have to build them up. I am reminded of Dr. Eggleston, who was my mentor, an American professor. He used to tell us on rounds, GD, feed him like a pig. What he meant was that he should get very high calorie, high protein diet. And whether you achieve that by a nasogastric tube, by a feeding, jejunostomy, or whatever, or TPN, but you need to take care of their calories. And albumin more than 3.5 is desirable. All of them are smokers, if not all, majority. So it is a surgeon's responsibility for a patient to quit smoking. And on this moment, I appeal to all my resident friends that people who attend this class should be very good in art of helping people to leave smoking. I would like one of the young surgeons, maybe Saba Khan, has volunteered to write up a page in the comment how to prevent, how to help somebody to leave smoking. And I also give you a reference that Washington Manual of Surgery and Washington Manual of Medicine both write about this to the best possible way. Saba Khan, if you have accepted, please write, otherwise Akshay will do this. Okay, whoever volunteers. Then all of them have got bad chest. So friends, what I said, you take care of their nutrition, number one. Smoking, number two. Their bad chest, number three. Oral hygiene, number four, and built up their hemoglobin. So these are few common preoperative workups to prepare the patient for surgery. This is good, Saba. This is what will be asked to you in your exam, that Sunny, how will you prepare this patient for surgery? Now, this is what the examiner wants to know. Then what is your aim of doing this surgery? The aim is, sir, R0 resection with radical esophagectomy and lymphadenectomy is our target. If you want to, good evening, Professor Prasad. I'm stepping in your area to a very smaller extent. You can correct upon and add upon whatever. If you would like to share the screen, please say so. I will get you on the camera. And R0 resection. And now the treatment, the surgery is the best treatment for T1, N0, M0, T2, N0, M0, T3 or T4 with N1 following neoadjuvant chemotherapy. The mortality has decreased from 10 to 5% in majority of the centers. And good evening, Professor Prasad. Professor Prasad is a very dear friend. He is Chief of Surgical Oncology in PGIMS Rohtak. We are good friends for last 25 years. He is an excellent teacher, and we also share our birthday. So that's very nice to see you here this evening. And when we are deciding, there are tumor factors and there are patient factors. Today I am sharing a very important definition. What is resectability? When we say resectability, is defined as feasibility of tumor resection in an operable patient. So when we say resectability, that means patient should be fit and the lesion should be fit. The inoperable lesions are mets into the liver, lung, bone, brain, extra, and extra regional lymphatic spread like supraclavicular, mediastinal, intra-abdominal, aortic and celiac. The nodes along the esophagus, if oily, can be taken out along with. Now, perioperative management. I want the residents to note down, I first said how to build up the patient, then perioperative management. This is what the examiner wants you to know, because if your boss has kept an esophagus, he wants you to prepare the patient. Now, perioperative management, you are supposed to know. So the first important thing is optimize all comorbid conditions. Respiratory care. When we say respiratory, that means take care of all the factors: COPD, secondary infection, bronchospasm, stop smoking, incentives parameter. Then number three, the colon preparation, where the patient has some feasibility of stomach not being possible to be used. In atherosclerotic, if you are anticipating a colon mobilization or a colon conduit, you need to check the vasculature by angio. Rule out colonic diverticular disease. Patients should have all prophylaxis for deep vein thrombosis. A double lumen tube so that the corresponding lung is collapsed, the surgery becomes better. A epidural analgesia to prevent post-op pain and to minimize lung complications. Proactive treatment, anticipation and management for supraventricular tachycardias. A feeding jejunostomy. And nurse the patient head up. Now, as it comes to surgery, esophagectomy can be abdominothoracic for lower third and middle third. The two common things you are supposed to know is if the anastomosis, these two names you need to know. If the anastomosis is in the chest, it is called Ivor Lewis, and if it is 3 feet in the neck, then it is called McEwen's. The lower third can be dealt through the left thoracoabdominal incision. Much of surgery would not be asked to you if you know the principles. I'm teaching you as much as you are supposed to know. The transhiatal is a palliative technique. It is meant for people who have pulmonary morbidities or a bulky tumor. If the tumor is too bulky or is involving the bronchus, then the transthoracic approach is needed. The transhiatal has 25% loco-regional recurrence, 15% systemic, 15% both. You must know, friends, the structures removed. Nobody is going to ask you steps, but the structure removed in a radical esophagectomy. Like you're not supposed to know, the structure removed in a modified radical mastectomy. So is radical esophagectomy. N-block transthoracic esophagus. Number two, lymph nodes in upper abdominal, mediastinal, and deep cervical, lower. Thoracic duct, aesophagus vein, posterior pericardium, and adjacent pleura, and at times right intercostal vessels next to the tumor, all are removed. What is the morbidity from radical esophagectomy and lymphadenectomy? The pulmonary complications are 20 to 30%. Remember, the cause of pulmonary complications other than aspiration are bronchorrhea. There are a lot of pulmonary secretions because of vagal denervation. There may be ischemic ulcers in the bronchi because of bronchial artery ligation. Recurrent laryngeal nerve injury, which is around 40%, can result in hoarseness. This you must know. The recurrent laryngeal nerve injury can lead to hoarseness, aspiration, and at times permanent tracheostomy. Phrenic nerve injury can lead to atelectasis. And the worst disaster is a leak. Now, what are the choices we have? Choices we lower third esophagus squamous cell carcinoma. Partial, good evening, Dr. Pankaj. Partial esophagectomy and anastomosis in the chest, or subtotal esophagectomy, transhiatal or transthoracic approach. If stomach cannot be utilized as a conduit, then colon may be used as a conduit. Adenocarcinoma type 1. Partial esophagectomy. with resection of proximal stomach. The reconstruction transthoracic or transhiatal, depending upon the case. Adenocarcinoma type 2 and 3. Total gastrectomy, because it is more like carcinoma stomach. So you do total gastrectomy, D2 lymphadenectomy, and partial esophagectomy. Pyloroplasty is needed only if you have a very muscular pylorus and a narrow pylorus. Otherwise, the pylorus is dilated from within and nothing more is needed. Let's come down to complications. My dear residents, complications you're supposed to know because you are the people who will pick them up in the ward and call the boss on a Saturday evening. Sir, this has happened. The complications can be, number one, intraoperative. I repeat this every day on rounds. When somebody asks you complications, always start intra-op, immediate post-op, delayed, and late complications. When you say like this, half the marks you get only this, that here is a boy who thinks rationally. You should not be talking about stricture first and bleed the last. So, intraoperative, organ injury and bleeding. What organ will be injured intraoperatively? Spleen, left lobe, and there are big vessels all around. In transhiatal, this is a usual question. When you are not catching any bleeders, how does the bleeding stop in transhiatal? It is a blind process. Because it is based on the principle. The blood vessels to the esophagus, they break down into very small branches 1 centimeter away from esophagus. And these branches, the bleeding stops of its own. Tracheobronchial injury can occur in 1% of the patients, requires direct repair. Pneumothorax is not a complication. It is a sequel of transhiatal esophagectomy. Recurrent laryngeal nerve, 1 to 20% injury. Early post-op. Atelectasis, pneumonia, effusion, and supraventricular tachycardia. Remember, all surgeons should be able to pick up supraventricular tachycardia and as well as treat it. The anastomotic leak is the most disastrous complication. If it happens in the neck, it is managed easily. If it happens in the chest, it can have pretty bad outcomes. Chylothorax. Chylothorax can also be pretty debilitating disease. You got a long case, you got a long question, you got a short question on chylothorax repeatedly. If it is more than 1 liter, on 6th day, it requires treatment. Intestinal obstruction and hiatal hernia are some of the less common complications of esophagectomy. Late complications, number one, anything which you anastomose can stricture. Number two, whatever surgery you may do can have recurrent disease. Now, friends, that finishes the surgery part. Now, a bit of palliation you should know. The surgical palliation is best done if you, by reasonable judgment, know that the lifespan is more than 3 months. only then, because the palliation has one inbuilt principle. The life should be saved. The patient should not die during palliation. Self-expanding metal stents. You get a note on this repeatedly, and examiners are fond of asking, what are SEMs? Self-expanding metal stents. Now, what are the utility? They are very useful in middle and lower esophagus. The lumen should be minimum 10 millimeter. And whatever is the length of the tumor, add another 5 centimeter to the length. Currently, we have stents which are polyurethane covered, which prevent tumor ingrowth and are also useful in teofistula. Current stents also have valves in it to prevent reflux into the esophagus. When I was a resident, there used to be a plastic tube called Moussebarbin tube. It used to be pushed and the funnel used to be kept on the top of the tumor, and it used to erode the esophagus, rupture, fistula formation, all complications. Now, even today, when the science has advanced, there are complications of the stents. The young boys, please write down. The early complications are chest pain and incomplete expansion. Late complications, tumor ingrowth, stent migration, and food impaction. All stents can precipitate bleeding and fistulization. Palliation by radiation and chemotherapy. The radiotherapy has 75% palliative for dysphagia. The results are maximum come at 4 weeks. When we have SEMs following radiation, the stent patency is for longer time. If you want rapid palliation for somebody, he should have a stent or laser added to it, radiotherapy. NDAG laser is the commonest laser used. Now, all of you should know about new adjuvant chemoradiotherapy for carcinoma of esophagus. Friends, the data has shown that for all patients of T1N1 or T2, T3 with any N, the survival was 49 months in patients who had neoadjuvant chemoradiotherapy vis-a-vis who only had surgery, who had 24 months in early lesions. The combination was better for loco-regional control. Now, what are the principles? What are the advantages of neoadjuvant chemoradiotherapy? Number one, it decreases the stage of the tumor. Number two, it prevents the seedlings intraoperatively. Number three, since the blood supply to the tumor is intact, so the chemotherapy has the best effect because it reaches the tumor. It is the early treatment of micromets anywhere in the body. Radiotherapy is also more effective because the tumor has more oxygen supply to it. For radiation, the target can be easily picked up and treated by giving neoadjuvant chemotherapy. You can always check the response of the drugs to the patient. Now, what is the usual pattern of neoadjuvant chemotherapy? You should know, is a combination of weekly 5 cycles of cisplat 5-FU or paclitaxel and carboplatin weekly, and 45 to 50 grays of radiation. All this given in 5 weeks, and then there is rest for another 4 to 8 weeks depending upon the nutrition and the departmental policy, and then the patient undergoes surgery. You should not know the regimens, but if you know the names of the common drugs. So if you remember cisplat 5-FU or cisplat 5-FU apirubicin, there are some people who give 3 cycles before and 3 after the surgery. So if I have to summarize, we have discussed today cancer esophagus. I have specifically told you the Asian belt. When it comes to etiology, I told you dietary factors 5, lower esophageal 4, and obesity. If you remember this much, more than sufficient. You need to know the pathology, squamous cell and adeno as separate. You need to know about Barrett's metaplasia. We said when it comes to signs and symptoms. Then we discussed the lab. The relevant labs were only hemoglobin, LFT, albumin, alkaline phosphatase. When it comes to chest X-ray, we said there are 3 kinds of disease processes. Number 1, because of cigarette smoking, COPD and related things. Number 2, metastatic disease. Number 3, aspiration. Then we said the barium. Barium has a role of a roadmap, knowing the proximal and the distal. It also tells you fistulization beforehand. And the long axis of proximal and distal esophagus, the length of the tumor indicates inoperability. We also talked about endoscopy. We discussed about EUS. We emphasized that the EUS is better for T. And CT is good for metastasis. We discussed that if we have to analyze, the T is best picked up by EUS. The nodal status can be picked up, not very clear, but on EUS, if you find the nodes more than 1 centimeter hypoechoic, round, discrete, they are likely to have metastatic disease. We also said that the PET CT is a better investigation to evaluate neoadjuvant response in tumors. Then we discussed the pre-op optimization, perioperative care, and I also said that they are by far optimization points are similar in all esophageal diseases because all require major surgery and well, cancer requires more major, but then even stricture and ecclesia at times can be difficult. You need to optimize them. Cigarette smoking, albumin, nutrition, respiratory, orodontal, hemoglobin, common for all of them. And we discussed radical esophagectomy, the structures removed, and complications intra-op, immediate post-op, and we concluded by saying the advantages of new adjuvant chemotherapy, radiotherapy. So friends, this has been in nutshell what is required by a young surgeon. If Dr. Sanjeev Prasad would like to share screen and give his ideas, because he's examiner for young surgeons, he's examiner for oncosurgeons. So if he's here, Dr. Sanjeev, if you are willing to share, it'll be nice. If not, he can write some comments, right? So, friends, with this we conclude. Thank you very much for being with us on Sunday evening. Next time we meet again with some interesting topic. Thank you.